time which had passed had seen many things change for the workers, including that thing which they thought would always remain constant, the factory itself. The gears, the metal platings, the ironworks, the grindings, the millings, the cogwheels which turned, seemed perfect in a Victorian sense, seemed understandable, the mechanical over the electronic, gears grinding, fuel supplied, product produced. And then, a control board, primitive as it was, a few chips here, a few chips there, transistors not very sophisticated, but that would be the thing which told the gears when to move. That would be the principle of the grinding and the conveyor belts and the turning and the moving. It could stop the gears, this little board, so much smaller than a person. And Mrs. Nackerly called into work, wondering why her husband Jim had not removed himself from the lunchroom. She sits beside him in the plastic chair with the metal legs, and she asks, and slowly she finds out each day he had prolonged his lunch a little more to the utmost beyond the point of reason, because he did not look forward to going back on the factory floor. There wasn't a vote or opinion. The workers there weren't asked, "Do you want this board to replace a human being?" It was installed and upgraded, and more of its kind came because electronics love to reproduce. Taking that into account, becoming less skilled at the job they had done well for so long, the workers in the factory began to have doubts about the reliability, the efficiency, the purpose of the boards. And Walt Vinson, who had gone there to make sure the hands-on pride that comes with crafting something could be instilled into the items he was producing, was put inside a booth with a box and told to sit down. The boards weren't metal, they were some transient alloy produced far away by eggheads, people to which they could not relate. What were they doing there in a hard-working factory that was churning out good products? Why? Why introduce plastic and microchips and little conductors plated with little bits of gold? Was it really the gold that should have gone into the memory chips and not on the watches of the people who served? Regina Waverly simply left because she didn't see the point in being subservient to a board. So they had to take training. They had to learn things over again to be more compatible with the equipment. No more levers. The arms of the slot machines were amputated in favor of buttons with little lights behind them. Hugh O'Neill told the boss it was bullshit and got canned. Ed Pennyweather threw his thermos at a computer and was fined. May Haskell, the cleaning lady, going about her business with a mop, got a shock that went through her bloomers and made them smoke. It became less of a mechanical chore. Life itself had evolved around the factory. Why not? Why not the internal organism of the beast itself? Wouldn't a artificial heart at some point in science be perfected to the point of outperforming a natural one? Humphrey Gardner, a lover of simple pleasures, had one more red tape thing to file before he could go home. There was a question for them for sure. Could they really take the reliability, the inception of such Barney Clark? How many Barney Clarks before something became more reliable? Poor Fred Ditchup got his arm caught in the plate joiner when he was looking at the flashing lights on the control board and not at the gears. Should they say, stem cells, look at this. We don't want stem cells or their equivalent in our factory because they lead to mutations. They lead to clonings, which are imperfect mirror images of what we have here so solid and heavy and concrete right now. Is the potential within those fabricated things so great that the cost is part of the natural? Reginald Arnsby, the foreman, turned in his resignation papers when he saw a pointless future ahead. Enough people have said no. Enough people have concluded that if you're going to take something that was working, perhaps it wasn't working in the way the factory owners intended. Isn't that the only real logic? Because for them to replace a component that didn't necessarily need replacing certainly indicates some sort of conclusion, some sort of decision on their part. And they have taken measures to ensure that decision is all their own, only their name behind that decision, which is in and of itself a double-edged sword. Gladys Widget could no longer produce free and wonderful Xeroxes of her tits without security surveillance. So now, the control boards, inside the plastic housings stacked on top of each other with their own life support system, fans built inside to keep them cool, probably treated better than the people on the floor. Isn't there something real about gears moving as opposed to a chip sitting implanted on a board? Something more innately profound that we can understand. Bill Hartford was let go when he cleaned his keyboard with a tampon and a fellow worker yelled sexual harassment. Chips were installed, the boards were there. Factories becoming automated, get with the times. That's what they were told. Some had to be let go, some left of their own volition, simply because the change was not what they wanted. Didn't matter if it was a change for good, bad, or indifferent, it just didn't feel right. Bryce Spooner brought his dog Fritzy in, like he had done so many times, but the dog peed on a power strip, and he was canned. They had invested, they had become involved. The quality of their day inside affected the quality of the rest of the day outside. So can you understand the conundrum, the factory scenario, the upgrades? Can you breathe life into the thoughts that it percolates within your mind and say, not only do I see their formation, not only are they 3D and real to me, I see the strings on the balloons and what they're tied to, not just the floating sentiments in the air. So let us talk of upgrades, if we must. Let us talk of working with the mechanical and putting in a control board. Ideally, the control board itself should be of as little interference as possible. It should be integrated as smoothly as you can. It shouldn't stick out or be on a pedestal or always need maintenance or be in everybody's face. If you have to have a control board, it should be an invisible one, stuck somewhere. When you need it to make a call, it does, and it stays out of your way. Isn't that the purpose of electronics themselves? Convenience? Entertainment facilitation? Doing some things we'd rather not have to crunch the numbers to do ourselves? To find a reliable control board that had a philosophy of gears, that might be a worthy grail to pursue. Beatrice Leonard was hired because she had no soul.